Hello class, welcome back to your online class. So today we'll be discussing the last topic from your chapter, absorption by roots. We are following the reduced ICSE syllabus. Okay, so I advise you to also go through the topics, because most of the topics has been reduced from within the chapter also. So we are following the reduced ICSE syllabus. So according to that, we are on to the last topic from this chapter. Today we'll be discussing about the forces which are contributing towards the ascent of sap. Now, what is ascent of sap? Ascent of sap means upward movement of the sap. Okay, so what are the different forces which helps in upward movement of the sap? Okay, from root to the other parts of the plant. Okay, so first we will be discussing about root pressure. Now, name itself signifies that this particular pressure, root pressure, pressure is created in the root region. Okay, now because of simultaneous osmosis taking place through the cells of the root, okay, certain pressure is generated within the root region, which helps in the movement of the sap from a root region to the other parts of the plant. So now we will be discussing two structures based which will help you to understand root pressure in more properly. Okay, and keep one thing in mind, that these two structures are very much important from your ICSE point of view. Most of the time, if any question is asked from this particular topic, that is root pressure, it would be asked according to this two structure that's given in your book too. Okay, so let's go through those two structure. Okay, so the structure that's given there, it's a cross section of a part of a root. Okay, so generally they'll ask you to label the different parts of a root cells. Okay, so here you have, first, as we know that root hairs are the extension of a epidermal cell only. Okay, so you have a root hair, then you have a epidermis layer, then you have a cortex region. Okay, the central pith is your xylem. Okay, that you can see here, then surrounded by it is your phloem region. Okay, so you will be asked to label only these few parts. Okay, more than this they do not ask you. First they will ask you to label the parts, and then they will ask you generally they will ask you to define what is root pressure. So what is root pressure and how is it produced is, as we know that outside the root hairs, soil contains much amount of water as compared to the inner cells, right? So what happens? Osmosis is going to take place, because we know that water moves always from a higher concentration towards the lower concentration. So water moves, it's absorbed by the root hair. Root hairs are semi-permeable, so we know that water can simply enter the root hair. Okay, then it will move through the epidermis region and then your cortex region. So what happens is, generally because of the osmosis, this cortex cells, sometimes it becomes turgid. Okay, and since the water content here will be more, so again it will be transferred to the places where the water content is less, right? So continuous movement, osmosis, causes your water to urge into the xylem region. Okay, so because of the continuous movement of osmosis of water in this particular region, the pressure is generated in this region, because of which your cell sap is able to move towards the xylem. So this pressure created in the root cells because of the continuous movement of the water through osmosis and the turgidity of a cell is referred to as a osmosis. Okay, now same thing we'll be discussing with another diagram. So we'll be discussing the same topic, that is root pressure, with the help of this diagrammatic representation. Here we can see that you have a root hair. So we are discussing the same topic, okay, just because in your ICSE they generally give you two diagrams in order to upon which questions are best. Okay, first one and this one, that's why we'll be referring to both the structure. Okay, but this is just the diagrammatic structure, that was the cross section of the root. Okay, so we have a root hair. We know that root hair is surrounded by a soil which contains water. Okay, then you have an epidermis cell here. Okay, so through osmosis, water from the soil will enter the root hair and then into the epidermal cell. Then we know it will move on to the cortex region, and because of the continuous osmosis in the cortex cells, okay, and the turgidity of those cells, because once the water enters, obviously, right, the cells are going to swell up. And then turgidity means what does it mean? It means that those cells will no more be able to take in more amount of water. Okay, so what happens if that neighboring cells has less contained water? From the turgid cell, the water will move on to next cell again, right? So that's how the root pressure is built up, and then those cells have, because of this root pressure only, is being able to move on to the xylem vessel, because we know that xylem are the conducting elements of a plant. With the help of the xylem vessel only, the water is conducted throughout the plant. Next, we'll be discussing two experiments regarding to this xylem vessel, whether is it really that xylem helps in conduction of water, or are there other elements which helps it. In order to prove that, we will be discussing two other experiments in a while. Okay, so I told you first and the second, the structure that we have discussed today is very much important from the exam point of view. Generally, most of the time they ask you from this two structure only, they'll ask you to label the parts. Okay, like they'll just give you this line and they'll ask you to write what is it, what cell is just adjacent to your root hair, what cell is present, so epidermis, then after that what comes, cortex. They'll ask you to label like that, okay, and then they'll simply ask you to define root pressure. Okay, so next let us discuss other forces resulting into ascent of sap. Okay, we have discussed root pressure, how is it caused? Because of the continuous movement of the of water from a soil to into the cell, because of that osmosis, continuous osmosis and entry and the exit of the water. Okay, because of that pressure is built up in the root, that is referred to as a root pressure. Okay, so we'll be discussing now other topics resulting into the ascent of sap. We have discussed root pressure in detail. Okay, next we just have to understand what does this mean. Okay, capillarity. Okay, so we know that water is lost from the leaves of a plant with the through the process called transpiration. So transpiration means what? Loss of the water from the leaves, from which generally you have on the leaves, you have a pores, right, called stromata. Through that, the loss of water takes place. That is known as transpiration. Now, once the water is lost through the leaves, obviously the vacuum is created. Now that space has to be filled, so the absorption, conduction of the water takes place. But we know that conduction of the water, the main element which helps in the conduction of water is your xylem. So xylem, the structure of a xylem is such that they have a very narrow tube like structure. Okay, narrow tube like structure. So we know that pressure equals to force by area. So pressure and area is inversely related. Inversely related means if your area is very small, then what will happen? More pressure will be exerted. If the area is if area is less, then what will happen? More pressure will be exerted. And if the area is more, less pressure will be exerted. But since your xylem vessels are a very narrow tube like structure, so that means the area is very less, the lumen is narrower. Okay, because of which more pressure will be exerted. Okay, because of which the conduction of the sap through the xylem would be easier. Okay, so that is only known as capillarity. Narrower structure of the xylem is helping in building up a pressure, which is helping in conduction of the sap. Okay, that's known as capillarity. Now next one is your transpirational pool. Like I told you that most water is lost through the leaves from the stomata region, that's called transpiration. So vacuum is created, right? Now vacuum is created, so that vacuum has to be filled, right? So water, because of that vacuum only, water is pulled from downward. Okay, the conduction of the water is taking place. That is known as your transpirational pool. Now transpirational pool is also supported by two kind of force, that is cohesion and adhesion. Okay, now first cohesion. In this case, molecules of similar structure, they have a nature of sticking together. For example, some of the molecules, okay, like water. water molecules, they have affinity towards each other, because of which they stick around each other only. Okay, so once the because of the transpiration, the water is lost through the leaves. So what will happen, since the water has an affinity, so it will be pulling the other water which is lying just below it, so okay, in other cells lower to it. So that is known as cohesion force. Okay, now another one is adhesion force. Now in this case, what happens is the affinity of two different substance to remain together. Okay, for example, in this case would be your surface of leaf and your water molecule. The cells present in the surface of the leaf and water molecules, they have an affinity to stick together. Okay, so once the water is lost through the leaves, what happens is, since they have their water lover cells of the leaf or water lover, obviously they will try to pull the water from the other regions in the cell. So that's how the transpirational pull takes. Because of this transpirational pull only, water from the lower water can reach the tall trees also because of this transpirational pull. Okay, so transpirational pull is possible only because of this two property, that is cohesion and adhesion. The two property, that because two molecules of water, they are water, they have affinity towards it, they always stick together. Because of that also, and another is, since the cells of the surface of leaf and water also has affinity towards each other, so if the water somehow is lost through the surface of the leaf, then it will try, if there is a water around, it will try to bring it closer to itself because it has affinity towards it. So that's an adhesion force. Okay, generally from this topic they will ask you to define what is transpirational pull, what is cohesion force, what is adhesion force. Okay, in case of the difference between cohesion and adhesion, in cohesion same kind of substance, okay, same kind of molecules, but in case of adhesion, different types of molecules stick together. Okay, so then generally they'll ask you to define these terms. Okay, and those two structure that we have discussed earlier, they'll ask you in diagrammatic type. Okay, 5 marks question, they will generally give you the diagram, ask you to label it, and then they'll follow it up with definition of any one of these. Okay, now next topic would be, we'll be discussing two experiments in order to prove that xylem is the conducting element in a plant. Xylem helps in conduction of the water from the root to the different parts of the plant. We'll be discussing just the two experiments. In your book, you have many other experiments, like phloem is the conducting element. All those experiments is not required according to a reduced syllabus. You just have to go through these two experiments that we will be discussing now. Okay, experiment would be to prove that water is conducted upwards through the xylem. Okay, so that's the aim of this particular experiment. So what are the materials required for this? The material required are, you need a plant, okay, fresh plant, which should be uprooted just before you set up this experiment. Okay, and then you need a beaker, and then water and stain. Okay, in this case we are taking eosin stain, which is pink in color. Why are we taking stain? So that if particular xylem is the one conducting the water, then that particular portion would be colored. It helps, stains generally help us in differentiating the cells. Okay, so here if xylem is the one conducting the water, then only xylem would be the one which would be pink in color. The rest of the cell would be colorless. Okay, so we will be observing the transverse section of a leaf, stem and the root. Okay, first, how would you set up this experiment? You will freshly uproot the plant. Okay, and then what would you do? You would take a beaker, fill it with water, you put few drops of eosin stain in it, and then you place the freshly uprooted plant. Okay, you will wash the root first in order to remove the soil, because the soil present in the root might be make a hurdle in absorption of the water, and it would prolong the experiment for a while. Okay, because of that you will wash the root properly, and then you will place it on the beaker. Okay, you will keep this setup for 3-4 hours, and then what would you do? You would make a transverse section from the leaf region, from your stem region, and from the root region. Okay, you will do a transverse section, and you will observe it under the microscope. Now when you observe it under the microscope, what would be visible is in all the three sections that you had taken, only the xylem region would turn pink, whereas other region would be other or colorless. Okay, so this proves that your xylem is the one conducting element in a plant. Xylem helps in conduction of the water, because what happened was while absorbing the water that was present in the beaker, since eosin stain was also present, right? And we know that while conduction of the water, along with the water, minerals also move in. So that's why the your eosin stain moved along with the water that was present. That's why resulting into colored portion of your xylem. Okay, xylem was turning pink in color because of that. Okay, so this is a very simple experiment. They generally ask you to reason out, okay, why is only xylem turning pink in color. Okay, they will ask you what experiment are we discussing, what is the aim of this experiment. Generally those are the type of question they ask you from a experiment based. Okay, generally the first question would be what is the aim of this experiment. Okay, what are the process we are trying to understand from this. If there is certain process, then we have to they will ask you to define it. Okay, then they will ask you reason behind why only xylem is colored, whereas rest are not pink in color. So they'll ask you this kind of questions. Okay, so next we'll be discussing another experiment. This experiment will also prove that xylem is the conducting element. A particular experiment is also proving that xylem helps in the conduction of water. For that you need two experimental setup. Okay, you need a plant, okay, which has a, you'll take the stem of a plant which has a leaves on it. Okay, you'll two stem of same plant of a similar setup. Okay, you'll take that stem, and then you'll take a beaker, two beaker like you have taken here. You'll take a two beaker, fill it with the water, and you'll cut the stem of a water under inside that beaker only. Okay, so that bubble is not produced. Okay, you will do that. Okay, and then what will you do is, in setup A, you will remove the outer covering ring of a stem. Okay, for making sure that you are removing the phloem portion of a stem. Okay, the outer ring, because we know that the xylem is centrally present. Outside that you have a phloem, so you will make a small incision of a outer covering. Okay, making sure that you are removing the phloem portion and not the xylem portion. This process is known as girdling, ring girdling. Okay, and in setup B, what you do is you will just remove the central portion, like you have seen here. No, you are removing the central portion. That means here, what are you removing? You are removing the xylem. Okay, you will keep this setup for a while. What would you observe is, in A, those leaves that were present in the stem are as it is. They are in a tertiary stage. Okay, but B, you will see that the leaves that was present have already wilted. Okay, now what does this prove? This proves that since you had a xylem in A, setup A, so xylem was conducting the water, thus maintaining the turgidity of the leaves, right? But in case of B, since xylem has been removed, right, thus cells in the leaves could not, since they need water in order to remain turgid also, right, so wilting of the water took place. Okay, so this particular setup also proves that your xylem is the one which helps in conduction of the water. So conducting element, xylem, water conduction is done by the xylem. So these two experiments are also very much important. Next, we are here in the end of this chapter. I'll follow it up with the reference question based on the topics that we have discussed today. Okay, that is the structure of the root and root pressure in brief, and these two experiment. Okay, what kind of question can this can come from these two experiments. Okay, so you go through this, I think it would help you to score well. Okay, if you go through this few topics. Okay, and I advise you to go through your class 10 syllabus thoroughly, the reduced one. Second time it has again been reduced in September, so you go through that syllabus again. Okay, I'll send you the link to that particular syllabus. Go through it, because from within some of the chapters has been fully omitted, but some of the chapters, though from within the chapter, few topics has been omitted. So for now, for your exam point of view, you go through those topics, okay?